So, today is another wonderful day, our exciting series of lectures about entomology. And in this afternoon session, we have a new lecturer named Professor Subir Sarkar from the University of Oxford. It is my pleasure to let you know that Professor Subir Sarkar is a world-class expert with broad interest, scientific interest. Amongst them are the interference between fundamental physics and astrophysics and cosmology, specifically theoretical aspects of dark matter, inflation and large-scale structure formation, the cosmology of neutrinos and other relict particles, primordial nuclear synthesis, cosmic microwave background, and etc. Professor Subir Sarkar was educated in India at the Indian Institute of Technology. Then he obtained his PhD from the Tata, the famous institute, Tata Institute for Fundamental Research in Bombay. And later, his world line passed through many places in the world, amongst them CERN at Geneva, Oxford Astrophysics, Rutherford, Appleton Laboratory, and etc. And finally, he became a professor at the University of Oxford. He has kindly agreed to visit us and give a series of lectures in this school. Professor Subir Sarkar has a number of others, amongst them a Niels Bohr professorship by the Danish National Research Foundations, Homi Bhabha Medal and Prize, and so on. Please join me to welcome Professor Subir Sarkar.
Thank you, Albert. Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction, which I don't deserve, because it's really nice to be here. I always wanted to come to Istanbul, and what better way to do it than to also share the experience with people who want to know about cosmology. I mean, so which is, of course, arguably the oldest intellectual pursuit of mankind. And you know, we are going to focus on physical cosmology, which is what we observe, and to understand the world in terms of fundamental laws, rather than cosmology in a broader sense, which is what anthropologists use, which is also a, you know, how to conduct your life. We are not going to do that. We are just going to find out about the universe we live in. Now, I gather you are from mixed backgrounds. Half of you are doing masters, half are doing PhD. Some might are undergraduate students, so I'm going to try to aim at a pretty basic level. So this lecture will introduce you to cosmology, not in the usual way by starting to write down the Friedman-Robertson-Walker metric, but try to ask you to come with me on a voyage of trying to find out what the universe is like by imagining that we have access to every modern instrument, every telescope that has been made, and we just want somebody to tell us succinctly what has been learned about the universe. So in the first lecture, I'll talk about what we observe. Next lecture, I'll set up the mathematical framework in which we do cosmology. In the third lecture, we'll go back to the early universe, which is much simpler than the modern day universe. And in the fourth lecture, I'll discuss nucleosynthesis, which is a key process that, in fact, the whole hot Big Bang model started from in the 1940s. So what we are actually going to discuss is pretty old physics. It was set up almost in a fully formed state in 1953 in a famous paper by Alpha, Hermann, and Gamow. And the mathematical framework goes back, of course, to the invention of general relativity. But the observational breakthrough happened in the 1960s when the cosmic microwave background was discovered. So these are the most important events in this timeline. So let's start by asking the following question. You know, this is something that might come up when you are discussing you know, maybe with your classmates or fellow PhD students who are doing biology or something, they're also tackling a very complicated subject, and they always keep telling you everything is very complicated, you know, we can't possibly have fundamental laws. And they are right, because they see a complexity just as we see. We see planets and stars and galaxies and groups and clusters of galaxies. And when we do large-scale maps of the universe, we see huge structures, millions of, hundreds of millions of light years across. And this is the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which is still taking data, where you have mapped out to about 600 megaparsecs. So some basic units you all know, I think. A parsec is 3 times 10 to the 18 centimeters. This is the distance at which an object on the sky will move by 1 arc second as we go around the sun. So if you observe it 6 months apart, that's the parallax. And that's why it's a convenient unit. And megaparsec is, of course, 10 to the 6 parsec. And the scale of the universe is actually a gigaparsec. That's 10 to the 9 times that. So 3 10 to the 10 to the 9 parsecs. Okay. So that is the scale in which you work. Now, this is actually extending to about 0.8 of a gigaparsec. So the question is, how can we describe this kind of complexity by some simple model? Because, you know, physics means doing things simply. We are not trying to complicate matters. So the first thing to observe is that the universe is very lumpy, as we see around us. But if we average it on bigger and bigger boxes, then it appears to get smoother and smoother. So this is a very busy plot taken from Max Tegmark, who compiled it, which shows if you take a box with a scale of 10 or 100 or 1,000 million light years, and you average within that, then you ask for what is the fluctuation and the density on top of the average density, and that is plotted here. So you have fluctuations on the scale of the present-day horizon or Hubble radius, which is of order tens of gigaparsecs, which are of order 10 to the few times 10 to the minus 5. But if you get up to the scale of a galaxy or smaller, then you would get up to density contrasts which are greater than 1. You are in the non-perturbative regime. But for a large part of this so-called power spectrum, you are actually in a linear regime. And in fact, the fluctuations are all smaller than 1. So therefore, they are tractable. They can be analyzed in a framework of first-order perturbations to general relativity, and we understand that quite well. In fact, this blue line that you see here is the expectation of the standard theoretical model that we use today to model the universe. And you can see that, broadly speaking, it's not such a bad fit, given that we are talking about, you know, 5 orders of magnitude in scale. And the probes that are being used to delineate this power spectrum range from the cosmic microwave background, which I measured. These are the fluctuations we see in the CMB. On scales of hundreds of megaparsecs, we have these large surveys of clusters of galaxies and the galaxy redshifts. So this is a redshift survey. For you take a picture of the sky, and on that picture, you then identify where the galaxies are. Then you drill holes in the back of the plate, and you put in light fibers at the position of each galaxy. And then you put that back in the focus, and you bleed that light off and send it to a spectrometer, and you measure the redshift of the galaxy. A very expensive business, which is why we don't have more than 1 million redshifts at the moment. But in the near future, we will have surveys coming online that will give us 10 or even hundreds of millions of redshifts, and then we will be in business. Then we can do some of the cosmological tests that I'll tell you about later. Then on actually on a broad range of scales, you have gravitational lensing, where you see multiple images of distant objects like point sources like quasars, lensed by intervening dark matter, and that provides a very unique and marvelous probe of the distribution of matter in the universe. And the Euclid satellite that is going to be launched in a couple of years will make major advances in that direction. And then you have the Lyman Alpha Forest, of which I'll talk more later. So broadly speaking, we see that the universe has got small fluctuations over most of its length scales, and therefore might be amenable to a perturbative analysis, which is really what we need to do or know to do. And it is also the case, if you look at a standard textbook, thank you so much. If you look at a standard textbook, I recommend this one by Jim Peebles, who was in America, what Zeldovich was in the Soviet Union. They formulated the hot Big Bang model of cosmology as we know it today, back in the sort of 60s, starting in the 60s. And what Peebles says in his textbook is that if you look at the brightest radio sources at some wavelength and you plot them on the sky, they are roughly uniformly spaced about us. I mean, ignore that little fault. Okay, so on this basis, it looks like the universe is isotropic around us, and this is the foundational principle of the standard cosmological model. The last slide I'll show in this lecture will be to indicate that what you cannot see at 3100 sources, but what you can actually now see with 800,000 sources, is that this is not quite true, but I'll come to that later, right? This is our starting point. Of course, the fact that the universe is isotropic does not mean that it is homogeneous, because in principle, you could have a situation like this, where it is isotropic, but there is a radial gradient in the density. So these different hatched regions might reflect different densities. So you might have some function of just the radius from our position, which is preserves the isotropy but not the homogeneity. And you, of course, you have the counter example of, for example, a ferromagnet, which is homogeneous, but it is not isotropic, right? So you need to be isotropic about every point in order for that space to be homogeneous. And there is the problem, because we can't actually decide whether isotropy holds at every point, because we are at only one point in the universe. And in fact, we can't move very far at all. We are basically stuck on this planet. We can send out a few space probes, at best go to the edge of the solar system, but we aren't going anywhere else. We aren't even going to the farthest reaches of the galaxy, far less other galaxies. So this is why there is an element in cosmology which is not shared by the other physical sciences. There is an element of philosophy here. We have to make some philosophical assumption. And that goes by the name of the cosmological principle, and I'll talk more about it in my evening lecture. It was actually formulated by Milne, who was the cosmologist at Wadham College in Oxford. Basically, he said that all points in the universe are equivalent, and we are at a typical point. This position was actually further extended by Bondi and Gold and Hoyle to a perfect cosmological principle, where we are not at any particular point in time either. Okay, in other words, that would be the steady state universe. Now, that was observationally falsified, okay, because we do live in a universe with a finite age. We have started from some hot, dense past. However, the other part of the cosmological principle, that we are at a typical point and nothing special about our position, this has persisted and people still stick by it, right? However, it is a philosophical point because we cannot test it. We are on some particular world line, and everything we see in astronomy comes along our past light cone. And on top of that, we have a little bit of data along our past world line, you know, if you do radioactive dating of rocks or whatever. But we can't move somewhere else and see whether it's the same light cone as here. We can't do that. And therefore, we have to assume it. This is no way we can actually experimentally verify this. So there are fundamental limits to what we can know in cosmology. It is not a physical science in that sense. Nevertheless, we have made great progress, and that's what we'll go through in these lectures. So first of all, let me introduce some basic tools in cosmology, which you may or may not be familiar with. The first thing is that everything on the sky is two-dimensional. It's flat. It's a picture. You need depth information, and that's very hard to come by. The redshifts that I mentioned earlier, that is a way to get depth information, but that's very, very expensive. But astronomers are quite clever. They look at a picture like this, which is a picture from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, and each of these points is some source of light. It could be a galaxy, it could be a star, it could be a quasar, you don't know, right? You, of course, can measure the magnitude, the amount of light they're putting out, and you can measure the map in some particular magnitude slice, for example. And when you do that, you observe that the number of sources which are brighter than some threshold S is going as S to the minus 3/2, okay? Now, why should you expect that? This is in fact something that Hubble showed in 1929, that was what he was inferring from the objects that he saw in the sky. If you have a Euclidean space and objects of identical luminosity which are spread at random, then their fluxes are decreasing as the square of the distance, but the number is growing as the cube of the distance, hence -3/2. Okay, this is sometimes called Olber's paradox. It's exactly the same problem. So this is the dimensionality of the space that is being reflected in this exponent. Now, astronomers don't actually talk about brightness in terms of, ergs per centimeter square second, whatever. They talk in terms of magnitude, which is just a logarithmic measure of this brightness. And they take the log, and then they multiply it by -2.5 to confuse physicists, so that something which has got a larger number is actually fainter, okay? And it's a log scale, remember that, because in astronomy you've got a huge range of things. Now let me show you the magic that comes from simply observe, doing this very simple exercise of asking, if I consider shells of galaxies, each of intrinsic brightness L, and I ask for the brightness at the origin, it'll be L by 4 pi r square, and then you ask what is the number in the shell, it's 4 pi r square dr, and you integrate it out, that's how you get the thing going as r cube. This is the plot of the actual things that you see here, and this is the line that in fact corresponds to a slope of -3/2. This is actually plotted in terms of magnitude, so this is a slope of 0.6. Okay, this is the number of galaxies per magnitude interval versus magnitude, and you can clearly see that they do follow the expectation that you had for random distribution of objects in Euclidean space. Okay. However, observe that there is another line here, the ones with the crosses, that has a slope of -1. Instead of -3/2, it has a slope of -1, -1. And they are stars. Can you figure out why? Because the stars are also emitting light according to the inverse square law, the same law for all objects, but the stars are not distributed in three dimensions, they're distributed in two. So, like I said here, this one tells you the volume and this one tells you the flux law, right? So it's -2/2. Isn't this powerful? You looked at this picture, you couldn't tell which was which, but if you do this test, you can actually separate the stars from the galaxies, right? Very impressive. This is sometimes called the V-min, V-max test, and one example of how powerful it can be is when we discover a new class of sources like gamma ray bursts. When they were first discovered, these are just flashes of gamma rays. Initially people thought there was something happening on Earth. They were actually picked out by a network of satellites which had been put up there to monitor that the test ban treaty on nuclear weapons was being obeyed. When gamma ray bursts were discovered by BATSE, this was a particular detector, they were all over the sky. And the amount of gamma rays they were putting out was so prodigious that if you try to put them very far away, that means they would have to be converting nearly the mass of a sun into gamma rays in a few seconds. And people thought that was crazy. Maybe they are very close by, they're within the solar system. Well, the way to actually determine where they are is to do that log n log s test. And you see here that the actual data, which is this red line, does follow the -3/2 law, except that there are departures both at the very strong end and at the faint end, okay? At the strong end, there would be fluctuations because if you have a random distribution of objects, there is some chance that you're near one of them and that guy will dominate your total flux that you receive on top of the average background. So there'll be large fluctuations. You might be in a hollow or you might be in excess. At the faint end, that curvature that you're seeing there is because our assumption of Euclidean space no longer holds. You're beginning to actually see the fact that we live in a curved space-time. Okay? So this can be a very powerful test. This very simple thing can be a very powerful test. But you have to start from some initial simple assumption, see how far you go with that, and then when you find some departures from it, that's where you then focus in order to develop your model further. Right. Yeah?
This is a mixed picture of long and short gamma ray bursts?
Yes, this is all of them together. Yeah. Now, of course, we know a lot more about gamma ray bursts. You've identified the host galaxies. But this is from a time that was in 1998 that the first host galaxy redshift was measured. This is from years before that when there was a big debate as to what they were, what kind of objects they were. So the problem with this kind of test is that there are evolutionary effects. So there's other thing about cosmology, different from laboratory physics, is that, you know, particle physics is nice because every electron in the universe is the same. In fact, there is just one electron, as Wheeler famously said, right? But there is not just one galaxy. There really are 10 to the 11 galaxies, and they are different. And they are going to evolve in time. They're going to change chemically. Their light is going to change. So, for example, distant galaxies are typically bluer because we are seeing them as they were billions of years ago, not as they are now. So, at that time, they were dominated by younger stars, which are hotter, hence bluer. And then you have number evolution because galaxy number is not conserved, you know, because they cannibalize each other. They form mergers, they fall into each other. Andromeda, our nearest neighbor, is going to fall into us in 5 billion years. You just have 5 billion years, okay? But we know the trajectory, you know exactly what's going to happen. And therefore, the number of galaxies, to assume that the number of galaxies is conserved in doing a cosmological test is not a good idea. In fact, this was assumed, and people made wrong inferences from that. So I'll tell you more about that later. Now, of course, Einstein had no access to any of this data, and he was famously reluctant to even look at data. He knew the mind of God, so he saw it all, right? Now, he said that the universe is homogeneous and isotropic when averaged over large scales. And in the next lecture, we'll see why he arrived at that conclusion. This was actually in order to obey something called Mach's principle, again, a philosophical idea. Now, the 2DF Galaxy Redshift Survey, this is a small, younger, you know, a junior cousin of the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. This was done from Australia, from the Anglo-Australian telescope. And you can see here the scale in redshift and the corresponding scale in light years. And you see this huge so-called cosmic web of galaxies, huge walls and filaments and voids, which is for how the galaxies are laid out. And people often look at this picture and say, well, you can see there are a lot of fluctuations, but on large scales, the distribution is homogeneous. And you know, I've stared at this picture many a time. I can't see that. You have to do a quantitative test, okay? I mean, how can you tell from looking at this? Now, actually, the galaxy distribution is not homogeneous. It is actually fractal on small scales. It has got a fractal dimensionality of 2 because the galaxies are on giant sheets. They're not really distributed uniformly in a volume. But the statement that you'll find in most textbooks is that averaged on very large scales, it becomes homogeneous, right? However, on the larger scales probe, so this thing goes out to 600 megaparsecs, and there is a wall here, the Sloan Great Wall, which is in fact 600 megaparsecs or so in length. So you are seeing structure on the scale of the depth of the survey. So you still have not convinced yourself that you have reached the point at which all structures are smaller than the depth that you are surveying. And therefore, the scale of transition to homogeneity is not at all obvious. When I say homogeneity, what I mean here is statistical homogeneity. Obviously, we are talking about some kind of a fluctuating field, so there is going to be variation from one end to the other. Yeah?
Sorry, the old galaxies, as you said, were hotter, so they have higher frequencies.
Yes.
But on the other hand, they get more redshifted.
Yes. No, so there are two parts to your question. You're saying that the more distant galaxies, of course, by definition, are more redshifted, right? But they are also, we are seeing them as they were when they were younger, so they were bluer in color. So when you take a spectrum, all this becomes obvious, okay? Because the spectrum of the stars is not uniformly scaled, as the redshift will uniformly scale every wavelength. The redshift does not distinguish between wavelengths. It moves every wavelength by the same factor, right? But the evolution of the stars is not a cosmological effect, it's a chemical effect, and that will not affect it the same way. So we can't tell the difference between an old nearby galaxy, in fact, we look at them for determining the primordial helium abundance, and a distant young galaxy, you can tell the difference. All right, so how do you actually do a check for homogeneity when we just have a flat picture like that? So this is called the automated plate measuring survey, APM survey. It's got 6 million galaxies in this picture. Each of those dots is a galaxy. And the different colors reflect the apparent magnitude. So you can measure it in different magnitude slices. Of course, the galaxies have a spread in their intrinsic luminosity. They're not the same luminosity. They're not standard candles. Nevertheless, statistically, if you look in different bands, roughly speaking, you'll be seeing that the fainter ones are further. Now, if this distribution is homogeneous and has overdensities on small scales, this is the standard model of fluctuations that cosmologists use following Peebles, who set it up back in the 70s, then if there is a characteristic scale of clustering, so there is like a standard rod which reflects what is the probable distance of the next galaxy, if I take this further away, that standard rod then subtends a smaller and smaller angle, right? So you should expect that kind of scaling when you look at faint galaxies as opposed to nearby galaxies. So by that I mean quantitatively you have to measure something, and what you measure is something called the angular correlation function, okay? This is the excess probability over the average of finding two galaxies within some angle theta of each other. So let there be some average density of galaxies on the sky per square degree, okay, let me call that n. Then I ask, what is the probability of my finding another galaxy within an angle theta of one galaxy that I choose? So that will simply be proportion to this average density times the square area that I'm looking at, right? But actually I'll find that there is an excess probability of finding a galaxy on top of that average, because galaxies tend to be more clustered together on a characteristic scale. Now that scale, let's call it R0, right, is the only dimension in the problem. Intrinsic to the galaxies, the second dimension that we are introducing is the depth of the survey. So if I want some kind of a scale-free distribution, something that scales smoothly with the only scale in the problem, namely R0, then I would expect that this correlation function, as I look to deeper and deeper objects, should just scale in proportion to R over D, because that's the only dimensionless quantity I can construct from these two scales, and the correlation function itself should be scaled by exactly the ratio of the inverse ratio of these two that comes out here. Okay. So this is what I would expect to find if it was the case that all these galaxies which are actually distributed in three dimensions have an intrinsic clustering length of order R0. And I'm looking at in a survey which has a depth of D, and then I would expect the correlation function, which are plotted here for different magnitude slices, to then come on top of each other if I apply this rule to them. And in fact, when they do that, this was done by Steve Maddox and company, who were actually at Oxford at the time, you see they do fall on top of each other. So these are more clustered, these are less clustered, but that is because these are fainter galaxies, these are brighter galaxies. If I adjust for the brightness of the galaxy, then I find that they have exactly the same correlation function. So this is a consistency test, which Peebles shows this in his textbook, and he argues that this is evidence that we do have a homogeneous universe, otherwise you would not expect this kind of consistency. But in fact, this is really just an argument that the fractal distribution does not hold to arbitrary large scales, because in a fractal distribution, there is no intrinsic scale. Okay, so you would not have any change of the correlation function with the depth of the survey. Now, this is getting slightly technical. I just want to give you a broad brush image of what kind of topics are interesting in cosmology, because you have, I suppose, varied interests, and you might find something that takes your fancy. So the correlation function that I just talked about in physical space is written out here. If n is the average density, then the probability of finding galaxy 2 within a distance r of galaxy 1 is just n squared times dv1 dv2, but it is not just n squared, it is n squared times 1 plus a little something. That little something is the excess correlation. Okay, and that excess correlation, which is the two-point correlation, is found empirically for the galaxies to form as a power law. And you might ask, at what point does this correlation vanish so that you achieve the average distribution, that is the scale of homogeneity? But of course, it's very hard to measure something that is going towards zero, right? It becomes more and more uncertain. So in fact, it is better to measure the conditional density, and this is something that the condensed matter people, in fact, brought to the game of trying to characterize galaxy distributions. They pointed out that actually we should not make a priori assumption, because as soon as I write this thing down, I'm implicitly assuming that there is a homogeneous distribution with the average density n, and essentially everything I'm doing is really trying to confirm that. But what if the distribution is like that of a glass, you know, or something more exotic, which our condensed matter colleagues always play with? They do not find this kind of simple behavior of point processes with little fluctuations on top of an average. So they have developed various tools, and of course you can relate that to the correlation function. In this case, it's a trivial relation. The correlation function is simply that conditional density divided by the average density minus one. But this kind of approach, which as I said is not particularly first principles, because it is simply seeking to confirm something that we already have as a working model, this can in fact be done and has been done on surveys of galaxies, where you in fact pick a galaxy, you draw a sphere around it, you count the number of galaxies within that, you make the sphere bigger, you make a new count, and you ask, is the count of galaxies scaling with the radius of the sphere as you would expect for a homogeneous distribution, which would be as R cubed, okay? And in principle, it could scale differently. So you define some standard scaling dimension and correlation dimension, which allows for other possibilities. But you really want that guy to be 3. And typically what you expect is that on small scales, it will not be 3, but it will approach 3 as you go to large scales. And the name of the game is to find on what scales you actually have the number of crowns going as R cube. Okay? Now let's look at some real data. First of all, I should point out that this test was first done on galaxies in 2005. Now, for many of you, 2005 is a long time away. But actually, if you think about the history of cosmology, it's just the other day. And it's remarkable that for nearly 80 years, we have been just assuming homogeneity and stuff like that without actually doing any observational tests at all. So finally, goaded by the condensed matter people that I mentioned, these people finally did a thing with the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. So they picked not very many, just about 4,000 galaxies. And these are called LRGs, luminous red galaxies. They are rather special. They're elliptical galaxies in the centers of clusters. And they are, so this is the Sloan Digital Sky Survey picture on the, imprint on the sky. And it's kind of a volume that goes in the third dimension, in the redshift direction. But it's a rather convoluted volume, and they divide it into four strips. And they measure, so the shape of this thing you're seeing in projection is something like that. So you can see that there is an obvious problem. You can't actually make very big spheres to fit into this kind of a survey volume. Okay, they just don't fit in. They will burst out of it, right? So there are so-called finite size effects. And because of that, whether or not the distribution is scaling is rather hard with current surveys, which for various technical reasons are often confined to this kind of beam-like or wedge-like surveys. We don't have surveys which cover the whole sky. That's coming with the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope, the LSST, but it's not here yet. Anyway, these guys do this. They do the count, and here are the results from what they counted. This is showing the counts of the galaxies in a radius of sphere of radius r. So that is 10 megaparsecs, that is 100 megaparsecs. This is a log scale, okay? And what is shown here is the galaxy count divided by the equivalent count for a random distribution, which you can generate by Monte Carlo, right? And therefore, if this thing was flat, that means you have reached homogeneity, because a random distribution by construction is homogeneous. But in fact, as you see here, the distribution on smaller scales is not, in fact, doesn't have a dimensionality of 3. It's got a dimensionality of 2. You can see it here, right? But on the larger scales, on 100 megaparsecs, it does seem to be tending towards homogeneity. Now, if you have done any experiment at all, you would ask where are the error bars, right? There are actually no error bars shown in this paper. And in fact, that is a problem because when you have a restricted survey volume, there are only a finite number of spheres of that size you can fit inside that. And each sphere is counting a different number of galaxies because it is a fluctuating field. So you're going to have a cosmic variance, okay? And that variance is, in fact, likely to be whatever it is for a homogeneous distribution with Gaussian statistics. We know it should be small, but what we want to know is what is it in reality. So this test was not actually very convincing. Here is another test that was done more recently. This was in 2012 with the Wiggle Z survey in Australia. Again, they are claiming that the dimensionality of the galaxy distribution is climbing towards 3, which is that black line there, on scales which are larger than 8th inverse megaparsecs. In this case, it was actually even weirder. When I read this paper, I wondered how they could have fitted in 100 megaparsec radius spheres into their survey volume, which was very convoluted. And then it turns out that they couldn't. It actually went outside the survey volume. So they filled them with galaxies drawn from a Lambda CDM model simulation. But of course, that is homogeneous by construction. So they were basically putting in the answer that they've got out, okay? You will find in cosmology this often happens. People are now so fond of simulations that they sometimes forget what is the actual physics of what they're doing, right? So please don't make this mistake. Think about what you're doing when you ever analyze some data, right? Because if in fact these guys were right and the 100 megaparsecs is the scale of homogeneity, there should be no structures or flows on scales bigger than 100 megaparsecs. Is that true? Let's go take a look. First of all, the cosmic microwave background is not isotropic. That's the thing that everyone tells you. The cosmic microwave background is accurately isotropic to 1 part in 10 to the 5. No, it isn't. If you point a detector at the sky, a microwave background receiver, a Dickey horn, you will find that the temperature in the sky is on average 2.728 degrees Kelvin, but it is actually about 3 millik hotter in one direction and 3 millik colder in the other direction. And this pattern in between is accurately fitted by this formula, which you'll recognize as the expectation for a boosted inertial observer in special relativity going through a thermal bath, which is isotropic, right? So you could interpret this dipole pattern that you see here as due to our motion through the cosmic microwave background. It's an interpretation, okay? We don't know whether this is the correct explanation, but if this were true, it means that we are moving at 368 kilometers per second towards that direction. So this is just like walking in the rain. There's more rain hits on your face than hits the back of your head. So you see a hotter sky in the direction that you're going. Now, as it happens, our sun is actually moving in the opposite direction around the center of the galaxy. So in fact, our total velocity is a bit higher. It's actually 620 kilometers a second. Now, the statement is that we are moving in a certain direction because there is something pulling us, which is local. It's a fluctuation in the matter density. So you say, yes, the universe is not perfectly homogeneous because if it were, then all directions are equivalent. Why should you go in one particular direction? It could be that there is a big lump of matter on that side, something it was initially called the great attractor. It's pulling us, and that's why we are moving at this huge speed, and we see this dipole pattern. If that were true, then if I average on a volume which includes that inhomogeneity, then of course, then it should go away. I should then converge to the so-called CMB frame in which we would indeed see the cosmic microwave background as isotropic. So the point I'm trying to make, and I hope this is clear, cosmology is done in the framework of this Friedman-Robertson-Walker model, which many of you are familiar with. In that model, if that were the correct description of the universe, you should see the CMB as isotropic, okay? The CMB is manifestly not isotropic. Therefore, we have to understand how we are to, boost our data to the correct frame in order that we can then apply the right formula to interpret our data, okay? Now, that is currently done on the understanding that it's a kinematic boost that is required in order to do that. In other words, that this velocity is very local and it will fall off as you go away from the Earth. It will just decrease to close to zero or cosmic variance, whatever it will allow. And indeed, we'll then start seeing the microwave background as isotropic. Is that actually true? In fact, it turns out that if you take a catalog of supernovae, this was a catalog of order 800 supernovae. So if you take shells of galaxies which contain the supernovae and you ask whether the supernovae themselves show a dipole pattern, it turns out that they do. And that is the dipole of the supernovae, that big red patch. Okay, the best fit is this blue point. And that black point is the direction that you are moving through the CMB. So within uncertainties, the two velocities are aligned, as you would expect them to be. But the point is that this is for small redshifts. This is for slightly higher redshifts. This is the edge of the survey. Beyond this point, there are no more supernovae. This is about 280 megaparsecs. Okay, and at this point, we are still moving at 260 kilometers a second, as you see here plotted. Whereas the expectation from the standard model is that this velocity should keep falling off. Okay. Now, each of these measurements is quite uncertain and they're correlated with each other. So the error bars are very large, and therefore looking at this, you might say, well, you know, this could be all just a fluctuation of that true story, right? But in fact, other people who have been, this is some work that we did a few years ago. Another group earlier had found an even larger flow, a coherent bulk flow. This is not something that you expect in the standard cosmology. And this flow was towards a closely direction within 20 degrees. The direction uncertainties are quite large. And the point is that this is all higher than what you expect for the standard picture of a Gaussian random field. And even when you go out as far as this shapely supercluster, which is this one here, at 260 megaparsecs, you still have a discrepancy. Now, this is getting worrying because we have to first establish a proper basis for our mathematical model. Okay, and in fact, this observation that we made was then picked up by another collaboration called the nearby supernova factory. And they found the same thing. They confirmed our result and took it deeper. So what this is now showing is, as a function of redshift, what is the mass of the object that you need in order to explain the velocity with which you're moving in that direction? So this blue band is their best estimate of the mass of the attractor that you need. And observe that the scale here is huge. This is 10 to the 16, 10 to the 17 solar masses. A galaxy has a mass of about 10 to the 12, including the dark matter, right? So that's about 100,000 galaxies. You need a density inhomogeneity of 100,000 galaxies at a distance of a few hundred megaparsecs to be pulling us, okay? And in fact, these people show that this, as far out as their data goes, I mean, this was a collaboration actually led by Saul Perlmutter, and their data went out to a few hundred megaparsecs, but even out to the Sloan Great Wall, they did not see any convergence. So the bottom line is that we have a problem. We are seeing that when we look at the distribution of galaxies in the sky and measure their peculiar velocity, not the Hubble velocity, not the redshift that you are used to, but the non-Hubble part of the velocity, right? These should be, in principle, they could be large on small scales. As I said, Andromeda has actually got the opposite sign. It's falling towards us. It's not going away from us. But do you expect that as you go on larger and larger scales, all these little things will get washed out and we'll start seeing smooth, spherically symmetric Hubble flow, right? What we are actually seeing when you look at the data with independent distance indicators, that and this is the largest such survey done, the 6-degree field peculiar galaxy survey, you find that in fact a number of such observations are indicating a large bulk flow, okay, and the same, roughly in the same direction. The problem here is that you need independent distance measurements. Normally the redshift is used to measure the distance, but we are now saying that we can't trust the redshift because these are peculiar flows, these are non-Hubble flows. So you need to measure the distance independently. And that is a serious problem. In this case, they are using something which is an empirical relationship that we know for elliptical galaxies between their brightness and extent. So it's called the fundamental plane relationship. Or you use something called Tully-Fisher relation that says that the mass, the visible mass, the luminous mass of a galaxy correlates with this velocity of rotation to the fourth power very well. So you use empirical relationships like that to determine the distance. And when you do that, you find that this is quite recent. This is from the 6DF Galaxy Redshift Survey, which has the smallest error bars to date. And they find that the peculiar flow is of order 400 kilometers per second on a scale of several hundred megaparsecs, whereas the expectation from the standard cosmological model would be according to a, this is a technical thing that I won't explain, according to what kind of a smoothing window you use, you would expect that to be this dotted line or this black line. And you can see that the observation is clear of those. Okay, so now we have a several sigma discrepancy between the expectation and the observation, right? Now, the idea is that with the current model that we use, the statement is that, okay, it's not exactly isotropic and homogeneous like the FRW metric. We actually live in a universe that has evolved from small density fluctuations, which we see on the cosmic microwave background, and this had a distribution that is described by Gaussian statistics, because they, you know, came from something like inflation, it was the quantum fluctuations of some scalar field, so everything fits, you expect that to be Gaussian. If that were so, then these Gaussian fluctuations have a well-defined, of course, they're Gaussian fluctuations, so we know what the statistics are. And we can compute exactly at what rate the fluctuations in velocity, etc., should fall off, as is indicated by these lines. Okay? So theoretically, what we expect is not quite borne out by the observations. Now, this tension has been growing, but of course, you could ask, if I really lived in a universe such as the one I just mentioned with Gaussian random fluctuations, then maybe on some sufficiently large scale and some corner of that universe, I would find the weird conditions that I'm finding. So in other words, how weird are we? How non-Copernican are we? Well, you can actually answer that question because people do these Hubble volume simulations in the Lambda CDM model, and the biggest such simulation is called Dark Sky. And if you interrogate the dark sky simulations, you find that less than 1% of observers who are like us experience a bulk flow as large as we see, extending out as far as we see. Okay? So in other words, bottom line of all this complicated story is that we are not Copernican observers. We are less than 1% likely to be Copernican observers, and we have to take that into account. So in other words, this is our Milky Way. This is how the sky looks at a redshift slice of 0.01, between 0.1 and 0.02, and then if you keep going, as you go further and further, you expect the sky to become more and more smooth. Right? And the statement is that even when you have got beyond 200 megaparsecs, okay, there are still fluctuations, there are still flows, and this is well beyond the scale of homogeneity that is talked about in the textbooks, where convergence to the CMB is supposed to have happened. So if I could just take two more minutes, then I'll finish, because that would be sort of it. Now, I'll leave you. So in these lectures, by the way, there'll be no simple answers. I don't have any answers. I want to raise questions because you guys want to do research. I'll tell you about where there are research problems, okay? Open questions in cosmology. I'll show you something which is very intriguing that we have been working on. Now, if this cosmic microwave background, the dipole, is due to our motion through it, we should see the same dipole in anything else which is also isotropic on the sky. One such thing is the distribution of radio sources. So I showed you a picture from Peebles' book with 3,000 radio sources. This is one from the NVSS catalog, which was done from Socorro, New Mexico. And this is from Molonglo in Australia. There are two surveys of the sky. This is NVSS, this is SUMS. They cover, they have of order million galaxies, radio galaxies, okay? And what we did was to combine them so you had a full galaxy, full sky survey. And then we looked for this simple effect that you would expect to find One is aberration, which goes back to Bradley in the whatever 18th century, I guess, which is that a star looks at a different position in the sky than where it really is for a moving observer. And this is how, in fact, the speed of light was measured initially. You also have the effect when you're moving that there is Doppler boost, so the frequency is packed as it comes towards you. So if you're looking at a distribution of sources with a distribution of flux densities, say distributed as a power law, then what would happen is that because you are boosted, you are seeing the fainter sources are boosted up in frequency, and therefore they come at a different point on the spectrum than they would normally to a static observer. And you have to correct for that. And this was all sorted out long time ago by George Ellis and John Baldwin. Okay, and using that this simple formulae from this thing, you can analyze that distribution of objects on the sky, and you find that there is a strong dipole in that data. Here is the dipole. It follows exactly a cosine curve as you'd expect. So the black lines are the data, the red line is the fit, okay? And you can actually visually see the dipole, okay, on an appropriate scale. So everything is fine. It is in the same direction as the CMB. Great. Slight problem. This dipole is actually almost four times as large as the dipole of the CMB. Although these sources are at a redshift of 1. The CMB is at a redshift of 1,000. It doesn't make any sense at all, right? So this surprising thing was first pointed out by a radio astronomer called Singhal in India, and nobody took any notice of him. They said they had not he had not allowed for various selection effects. There could be errors due to contamination by the galactic plane and so on and so on. We have taken account of all those things, and this result is robust. However, you could ask, how often would you see something like that by chance? So if you have a million sources, you can do Monte Carlo simulation. And if you do that, you find that this thing is 99.75% likely to be true, which sounds very impressive. But actually, in terms of sigmas, it is only 2.8 sigma, right? So if you're a particle physicist, you won't get out of bed for that, right? Because, you know, we only think 5 sigma is convincing. 3 sigma is not, you know, at all impressive. However, by the standards of cosmological inference, this is actually quite significant. Most of the results that you have heard about in cosmology are at this level. Nevertheless, I don't believe it. This is just a statement of the fact that it could be wrong. It could be a fluctuation of 2.8 sigma. The good news is that there is something called the square kilometer array right now under construction, and soon in a few years, it will give us not 1 million, but 100 million radio sources, and then you will know if this is true, right? But I'm just showing this to illustrate to you that the technology required to do this kind of analysis is very simple, right? And yet, people don't do these things. They, should ask fundamental questions which you can ask with existing data, not just look to the future. And this is, in fact, an open issue, which, in fact, needs to be understood, whether in terms of challenging the usual kinematic interpretation of the CMB or not, I don't know. But it is true that people have long ago talked about whether the universe might actually be not the standard FRW model, but a so-called tilted universe, in which our frame is not that of a isotropic Copernican observer. I think this is a good point to stop. Thank you. Sorry, I went a bit over time. Yeah?
I'm sorry, so the new observations are suggesting that the dipole in CMB is not due to the fact of our motion.
Oh, we don't know that. The dipole in the CMB is interpreted as due to our motion, and that would require a certain speed because you're seeing a dipole of order 10 to the minus 3, which is the same as V over C. So you expect a few hundred kilometers per second. I'm saying that the dipole in the radio sources is giving us not the same velocity, but a much larger velocity, right? That would then suggest, if it was kinematic, it should affect all of them equally, right?
The reason for the difference is unknown.
Unknown, totally unknown. not just unknown, but a real puzzle. Okay? It is as if that there is some intrinsic tilt to the universe in that direction. Now, that is so mind-blowing that we don't want to accept it unless it is statistically a fully convincing result. I'm telling you, because you know I believe in total disclosure about everything, that it is only a 2.81 sigma result, right? So don't get too worried, right? But this is something to watch. This is something to focus on, right? So I'm saying that by asking the simplest questions in cosmology, you soon discover that they're actually open questions. You know, you might think that it has been, something has been going on for over 100 years, all this has been sorted out. It has not been sorted out. So in other words, there's plenty of projects, plenty of things to do in cosmology. And you don't need to be in a big collaboration either. Yeah?
Is it something related to the dark, you know, when they say that something beyond observable universe is much more denser?
Well, the dark flow that you are referring to was actually, maybe I can show it here. The dark flow was I suppose you're talking about the same thing. There's a group led by Kashlinsky at NASA. He was studying the Sunayev-Zeldovich effect in clusters and deduced that there was a coherent motion even much higher than this. They saw something around 700 kilometers a second extending out to about here. Okay, not beyond the edge of the universe. They only went out to about a gigaparsec. Right, that's where the clusters of galaxies are. However, Planck has set an upper bound on the maximum velocity you can have, right? Averaged over the Hubble volume, which they can. And they claim to rule out this dark flow in the closest point at which they can also make a measurement, right? However, Atrio Barandela, who is one of the authors of this dark flow paper, who is also a Planck author, he seems to take issue with that, right? I would say it is still an open question. The dark flow is not accepted by the community of cosmologists, right? They think there is some systematic uncertainty that they have not yet identified. However, it is also true that the counter statement, which is that it is ruled out, is clearly also not established. So right now it remains a puzzle. Again, something that, you know, it's not just that you need more data, you need better data, right? You need control of systematics. And it is by highlighting issues like that that one then gets a motivation. It's a well-defined problem. You want to shoot down the dark flow, how many galaxies, clusters, whatever it is that you need, with what precision, and then you go for it, right? So right now that is not yet decided. But yes, it is in the same direction. Yeah?
I would like to encounter the Noether theorem of the mechanics. If the inhomogeneity of the universe implies the non-symmetry in the position, is it possible to think the momentum of the universe is not conserved?
The what is not observed?
Response to conservation. For example, if time is symmetric,
yes,
energy is conserved.
Yes. Okay. I now know what you're trying to say. So the fact that we are moving in a particular direction, that doesn't have to be anything intrinsic. It's the same idea like, you know, spontaneous symmetry breaking of the Higgs field. There is no significance at all to what direction you choose. It's some random direction. Okay.
So in regard to the total momentum of the universe, is it possible to say something from this beginning?
If we discovered, so far we have not discovered any rotation of the universe. We don't know that the universe has enough. Actually, at one time there was a claim that in the radio sources, same radio sources, you could see evidence of rotation. Right? People are talking about a Gödel universe, about the angular moment of the universe. That evidence has gone away. Right, so far we don't have any particular reason to believe in any conserved quantity associated with the universe as a whole. We don't know of any net momentum or net charge or net anything. The universe could be a fluctuation from the vacuum. Okay. Sorry?
Also with respect to what?
Yeah, exactly. So you have to have a frame in order to define that. This thing that I was talking about, the tilted universe thing, that is defined, the observer is defined with respect to the idealized isotropic co-moving frame in which the CMB would have looked isotropic.
Okay.
Okay. Now, once we establish, if these day things are established, then it will raise the kind of questions you're asking. But right now, we are busy with the data. Yeah. Yeah.
Is it somehow connected with the measurement of Hubble constant from the CMB and the local measurement? Because if the value measured by CMB 67 is same as a local measurement, so can I decrease because then this dipole, the velocity will change basically. So
the measurement of the Hubble parameter from the CMB, you infer it. You don't measure it. Because at the time when the CMB decoupled, the universe was exactly omega equal to 1 Einstein de Sitter universe at the time, at a redshift of 1068, right? Today it is not. It would be, at that time the universe was very homogeneous. The fluctuations were 1 part in 10 to the 5 on the last scattering surface. Today the fluctuations are of order 1. So actually I am surprised that the Hubble parameter measured locally within 30 megaparsec is even within a few kilometers per second of the CMB measurement. That is surprising to me. So I'm not so much worried about the discrepancy. I'm worried about how little it is, okay? Because there is no reason to expect the two things to be the same. One is a measurement in a locally inhomogeneous universe, right? And by the way, the people who make that measurement, the shoes, they don't even explain how they correct for this local peculiar velocities that I've just told you about, right? So I'm saying that when you infer something from the CMB, you're actually fitting a model to the CMB, which is a very different world model than the one that would fit the universe today. Because today we live in an inhomogeneous universe. At that time, it was a homogeneous universe, right? So there was a well-defined meaning to the term H-naught then. It is our present framework in which we do not consider any of these issues that we use the same model to analyze both sets of data and then ask for consistency between them. And that is useful because should a problem develop there, that means that that way of doing things is not acceptable, right? But that particular discrepancy is not the one I was waiting for.
Okay.
Yes?